Welcome to worship with First Christian Church of Lufkin, Texas. We're part of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. We're glad that you found your way to us this morning and invite you to worship fully. There will be songs that you can sing. We invite you to sing loud at home. And we invite you too to gather some communion supplies if you would like to join us in that special meal. At church, we would use bread and juice, but you're welcome to find whatever food and drink you might have available in your home. We celebrate an open communion table, which means that all are welcome to participate. If you're interested in connecting with others further beyond this worship service, we invite you to check out our website or Facebook page. You can find our website at fccluffkin.com, or you can call the church office at 936-634-8341 for more information about upcoming Zoom meetings and ways to connect. Prayer requests are welcome, and we invite you to send those to prayer@fccluffkin.com. We're happy to be praying with you and for you during this time. In just a few weeks' time, we'll be celebrating our high school and college graduates. If this is you or someone in your family, congratulations. We look forward to celebrating with you in this unusual time. If you would please call the church office, we'd love to make sure that we have your name on our list and give you some instructions about how we want to celebrate. We need to gather some information from you. Again, the church phone number is 936-634-8341. We look forward to celebrating this great accomplishment with you in just a few weeks. And now, friends, I invite you to gather with us for worship as we have our call to worship from Psalm 31.
I come to you, Lord, for protection. Never let me be defeated. You are a righteous God. Save me, I pray. Hear me. Save me now. Be my refuge to protect me, my defense to save me. You are my refuge and defense. Guide me and lead me as you have promised. Keep me safe from the trap that has been set for me. Shelter me from danger.
I place myself in your care. You will save me, Lord. You are a faithful God.
Recovered to pray for those who are sick, for their families, for those who grieve, those who have died to the virus, for healthcare workers, and for all who are joined by grief and by confusion during this time. So I invite you to join me, to join us as we continue to pray at 4 o'clock each day for all who are affected in this time. It's a way for us to be together in prayer. Today is Mother's Day, and so we remember and celebrate those who are mothers and give thanks for them, for those who have mothered us and raised us up and taught us many good things. For those who are our mothers and those who have served as mothers, we honor you and give you thanks. And we give thanks to God for your gift of life and the gift of your presence in our lives. For those who grieve today, the loss of a mother or the loss of a relationship with a mother, we honor you too and remember you in this time. For those who grieve the ability to become a mother, we pray with you that you might find peace and comfort this day. Let us take just a moment to pause and pray to God each in our own way. And then I will offer a prayer and invite you to join me in the Lord's Prayer at the end. Let us pray. God, you are a rock, solid, steady, steadfast. You're exactly what we need right now in this strange season of change and uncertainty. We've been accustomed to putting our faith in schedules and calendars and structures and plans, and all that has gone out the window. But you are constant. Your love never ends. Easter resurrection continues. And you invite us to be living stones. Stones alive in you. Stones that can be built into a house where you can dwell. Because you want to dwell with us. You want to dwell in us. So forgive us when we have been so stuck on our own ways that we've walled you right out of the center of our lives. Forgive us when our hearts have turned to stone and we have hardened ourselves against each other. Forgive our rigid need to be right instead of caring and compassionate. Soften our hearts toward our neighbors, soften our hearts toward ourselves. Nudge us into ways of living that honor life and care for all among us, particularly those who are most vulnerable. Take us as we are, mold us and make us into a living stone dwelling, fit for you to live in. May we who have received your mercy be quick to share mercy with others. For we give you thanks and pray in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hi, this is a little message for the kids who are out there. They'll have some questions. If you want to pause so you can talk about them, you can do that, or you can just let them be something that you think about. I wonder if you like to build. Maybe you have Legos at home and you can build stacks and things, or rocket ships, or funny little creatures, or even a tree or animals or who knows what. There's all sorts of things we can build there. Or maybe you have some blocks like these and you like to build with wooden blocks when you're at home. You could build a house or a school or a store or whatever you want to out of different different blocks. Have you ever tried to build with rocks? You have to have some flatter ones than this, but it could be interesting to see how high you might even stack those. Not very high for me. Our scripture today comes from 1 Peter, where it says that Jesus is a living stone. I wonder how Jesus could be a living stone. Not only that, it says that we're like living stones being built into a spiritual house. I wonder if that means that we're being built into something that God could live in. What do you think it means to be a living stone? What do you think God might be building inside of us? What do you think it might be to have God be inside of us? What kinds of things might you build today? What kinds of things might God build in you? Will you pray with me? Dear God, living stones? You want us to be living stones that can be built into something? We wonder how that is possible. We wonder what you might do with us. Help us to build with you today. We want you to live with us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Happy building.
Well, a mother, a real mother, is the most wonderful person in the world. She's the angel voice that bids you good night, kisses your cheek, whispers, "Sleep tight."
And you'll do wondrous things, my little minnow.
Never forget you, Dory, and we know you'll never forget us.
Mom! Mom, you're messing up my mane.
Oh, I've got one for you too. Ahoy, matey.
Tiana, your daddy should be home from work by now.
Mom, you're back!
I know I'm safe as long as I'm here.
She kisses my boo-boos, she braids my hair. We love you, mothers, everywhere.
Every breath of sin to Our scripture today comes from 1 Peter, chapter 2, verses 2 through 10. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good, come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices, acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you, then, who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God." Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of the hearts of all of us be acceptable in your sight. You are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In the Old Testament, kings believed that God gave them direction in their dreams. If they wanted to know what they were supposed to do in their administration, they would try to receive a direct word from God in their dreams. If they weren't getting any messages in their dreams while lying in their own beds, then they would sleep in the temple, where they believed it would work better. And thus, we have the origin of the time-honored tradition of sleeping in church. I wanted to point that out at the beginning of this message so those who would appreciate it the most would have a chance to hear it. Of course, with the new way of doing things, you can take a nap and pause the service and still hear the message. What a time to be alive. Your brick and mortar, lumber and nails, arches, rafters, flying buttresses, rock and concrete. If you were to tear down our building and build a new one for First Christian Church, what would you include? Would it have to have a steeple? Must you have a bell and a bell tower? Do you install a baptistry? Do you install pews or use removable chairs to give your building more versatility? When Jesus built his church, he didn't consider any of these components. When Jesus built his church, he started with a very small but firm foundation. Upon that foundation, he built a structure that has been rocked and windblown, shaken and flooded, even attacked by numerous enemies and illnesses, and yet has withstood and survived down through the ages. During a Sunday school class for 7-year-olds, one little boy suddenly exclaimed to his teacher, "Can we hurry up? This is boring." Immediately, the little girl to his left gave him a sharp elbow to the side and rebuked him. "Shut up! It's supposed to be boring," she said. What is this Church of Jesus Christ supposed to be? Are we simply in a church building that has become stiff and boring, weathered by the years and near extinction? Or are we a building church with veins full of life and the empowered goals of still wanting to reach the heavens? The church that Jesus built was a living church, alive with the living stones that were its building materials. Living stones that had as their cornerstone the very stone that the builders of the world had rejected. Though rejected by mortals, God previously chose this cornerstone so that it would become the foundation for his building on earth. Jesus had faith in his construction ability. Though he had the whole world from which to choose, he selected very simple material, a few fishermen, a tax collector, and some others of seemingly simple means and position. There were no kings in his foundation. He didn't use any successful business personalities on his first floor, and he completed the first stage of his structure without the help of aggressive marketers or developers. Jesus just used stones, a variety of living stones. He used stones that would weather the cause, stones that would not crumble under the weight that would be built upon them. The building material that Jesus chose was well suited for the building he intended to construct. For the church that Jesus was building was to be a living, breathing construction of dynamic proportions, one that would outlast the ancient structures of Jesus' time that still stand today. The Church of Jesus Christ was built to last an eternity. We still get hung up on the church building, though. Is it meeting our needs? Do we need to make major repairs rather than just continued maintenance? Should we add on or rebuild? Should we renovate our sanctuary and modernize to fit the times? Jesus is more concerned with building the church than the church building. If you build it, they will come. Ever since that line emerged from the movie Field of Dreams, we have been using it to describe everything from a shopping mall to a Major League Baseball stadium. But the truth remains, whether it's a church building or a baseball stadium, just building it is not enough. It's how you build it. If you don't build the baseball team to go with the stadium, people will not come. Not in the way that the owners want them to come. And if you build a fabulous church building but do not build the church in proportion to it, you end up with a fabulous empty church building. A certain church was having air conditioner installed in the sanctuary, and so the pastor was meeting with the contractor. The man asked the pastor a number of questions about the seating capacity, square footage, usual attendance, and so on, all the while taking notes. Then, in the midst of his calculations, the contractor suddenly crumpled up the paper he was figuring on and started over. "What's wrong?" asked the pastor. "Well, I was figuring for a theater instead of a church," replied the contractor. "What's the difference? Wouldn't they be the same?" the pastor asked. "No, not really," answered the contractor. "You see, in a theater, with all that's going up on this, with all that's going on up on the screen, there are certain biological changes that take place. Heart rates are elevated, blood pressure increases, and body temperatures begin to climb. In other words, there is a greater need for the cooling process throughout the room for when people get excited. On the other hand, in the church, well, you need most of the cooling up at the front where all the hot air is coming from." Can living stones create dead structure? Jesus built his church with living stones. In today's text, Peter calls us a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people. He goes on to say that because we are as such, we can proclaim to the world the mighty acts of him who called us out of the darkness into his marvelous light. We don't read anything here that talks about a sleeping church, or a stagnant church, or a church built with inanimate materials that are held together with mortar or nails. The church that Jesus built was built carefully, with carefully chosen building materials that, like the material of no other building, are alive and vibrant and continue to build themselves. Materials that will not become brittle and break apart, but that will continue to breathe new life into the church. You know, in all of my video sermons so far, I've worked hard to make these videos perfect. I find a quiet place where I won't be disturbed. When I make mistakes, I stop and start over or record another take. But that is not what our church is like. We make mistakes. We have flaws and imperfections. That's why this sermon is being done outside with the girls playing in the background. because this is where we live. This is where life takes place, where the real church exists, in the loud, dirty, distracting places where God's presence may be more difficult to ascertain, but where it shines forth more resiliently than ever. We are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Before Jesus, we were nothing. Nothing held us together. We were not a people. We were only individuals inhabiting the same world. Jesus changed our world, and that's exciting. Jesus made us into God's people by making us into His church. Jesus pulled us together and united us into something special. We have not been able to worship together in person for nearly 2 months now. The building is not being used, but the church continues. We find new ways to connect through worship and fellowship. We have reached out to support our neighbors in new ways. It has been difficult, but now more than ever, we can see that the church is not about a brick and mortar building. It is about relationships between one another and relationships with God. Each person is a vital piece of this church. Each time we connect with someone, even if it's just one person, we strengthen our bonds and build the church that much higher. Why does just one person matter? Can one person change the world forever? With the billions of people who now inhabit the earth, a statement like that seems trivial. Of course, one person can have an impact. One person can cause a degree of good or a degree of bad, but one person is not going to make much difference in the whole scheme of things. Yet we believe that one person has changed the world. That the organization of people started by one man over 2,000 years ago is still changing the world from day to day. That a small nucleus of people living in an ancient time has grown into the great body we call the church, and that will continue to grow in unity from now until the time that its founder returns to this world. We believe that no power on earth can cause this church to crumble because Jesus is the cornerstone and Jesus will hold it together. We're not about a church building. We are about church building. A pastor of a small southern church was on his way home when he met an acquaintance from town who is not a member of his church. After chatting a while, the man asked how many members the pastor had in his church. The pastor responded, 50 active members. The friend said, "My, that certainly speaks well for you." But the preacher responded, "Well, I wouldn't exactly say that. All 50 are active, but 25 are actively working for me, and the other 25 are actively working against me." When we work together, we build up the body of Jesus Christ. Jesus' original disciples didn't always agree on everything, but they knew how to work together in spite of their disagreements. They were able to build upon what Jesus had started. They found ways to do it together by sharing the responsibilities of church building. Jesus knew he couldn't do it alone. He knew that he needed others to help him. The job of building his church would be turned over to those who would follow him. And now, it's in our hands. How shall we build our church? Will we build with brick and mortar or with living stones? Are you willing to get your hands dirty? Are you willing to exercise your spiritual muscles? Are you willing to hold the light so that others can see in the darkness? Haven't you ever just needed someone to hold the light for you while you were doing something? Or maybe it's always been your job to hold the light so someone else can see to get a job done. Whether it's down in a dark basement or under the hood of a car, sometimes it's just too much of a job for one person to do alone. Jesus wasn't afraid to ask for help. He still isn't. He's asking us now, seeking our assistance in building his church, a light in the darkness of the world, a beacon in the middle of a stormy sea, and we're all he's got. As we emerge on the other side of this, and we will emerge from it, we will be changed. We cannot think that we'll just go back to the old ways of doing things. We've seen how businesses can be successful during this time by adapting and being creative. Churches have done the same, and it has caused changes in the way that we will do things from here on out. We will emerge from this time as a new creation. One that is more aware of the impact we have and can potentially have on our community and the lives around us. We cannot go back to the way that things were. We can only trust in God to guide us into who we will become. Let us pray. Gracious God, we stand before you. We look around at us and we see the church that you have built. Not the church of brick and mortar, but the church upon which was built upon the cornerstone of Jesus Christ. upon the living stones that were his followers and that are his followers. Gracious God, we ask for you to continue to work with us. Let us be materials, let us be living stones, living bricks, living mortar, so that this church may continue to grow and adapt and change to reach the world around us. God, we give you thanks for these opportunities that you have given to us, even in this time of darkness and difficulty. For you are with us always, and we know that in all things you have our backs, that you have us in your hands. And so we pray and rejoice in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Gather around a table that we call the communion table to celebrate the Lord's meal. And it reminds us of all those times that we gather around dining tables and kitchen tables and counters and all the different types of tables and places that we eat. And we share food with family. We remember sharing food with friends. And as we celebrate this meal together, we're united by our sharing in this bread and this cup. In 1 Peter, he says that once we weren't a people, that we didn't belong, and now we are a people, God's people. Once we had not received mercy, and now we have received mercy. At this table, we remember those gifts of belonging, of love, of generous forgiveness and mercy. And we remember how Jesus gathered his friends in an upper room, and took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. He offers it to us, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you." We remember too that Jesus took a cup and blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he offers it to us. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in his blood. Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we remember him. Let us be joined together in prayer.
Please pray with me. Our dear God, we are members of your family coming together in a new way with people we know and love. As we celebrate your table, we rejoice in this sense of being a family, of breaking bread and drinking this cup together, apart. We ask that, by the aid of your Spirit, we are sensitive to others' needs, hopes, and fears in this difficult time of social distancing. Please purify us by your love and heal us by your mercy so we might gather at the living waters with those who have conquered and say, Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and power and might belong to our God forever and ever. Amen.
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless, you are.
In 1 Peter, we hear the invitation directed to each one of us. Let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. One way we can be identified as living stones is to offer ourselves and the symbols of our lives, our finances, to God. If we're connecting virtually, let's think of those who make up our own church house. Bring faces to your mind. Bless each one with your heart. Now that's how it takes all of us together to be built into the spiritual house of our congregation. Because we are one part of the whole body of Christ, let us share our offerings and our very lives, knowing once we were not a people, but now we are God's people. Once we had not received mercy, but now we have received mercy. Let us pray a prayer of thanksgiving. With grateful hearts, God, we ask you to receive these tithes, gifts, and offerings to continue creating your house in this place. Help us recognize that we are your own people, eager to proclaim Christ's mighty acts as we are called out of darkness into this marvelous light. Lead us ever toward the shining light of life, even Jesus the Christ. Amen. And now as you go forth, remember this. You are the ones chosen by God, chosen for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be holy people, God's instruments to do his works and speak out for him, to tell others what God has done for you. So go into the world. Live as God's people, through the grace of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.